Mom moved the chairs around.
My rabbit.
I'm not gonna be in front of the team, boys. That's four.
He was a spare in place.
Dickie Johnson, all right.
What are you hearing, huh? That's a bad image. So many people. And when I do that, we need to go back and open a quick one. He's a good man. They enjoyed themselves. But it was their choice. You're going to do it. You're going to do it. Which was good, because I'm going to this way, and upgraded our cracker.
Well,
he took a lot of pride in it. You can tell when he was up there. He took a lot of pride.
Okay, you know.
Good morning, everyone. We'd like to welcome you here this morning, and all those of you that are joining us virtually. We know if it was a different time, we would be standing room only, and honor and pay our respects to Hector Martinez. Hector Martinez was born on November 11, 1927, appropriately Armistice Day, now known as Veterans Day, and passed away on December 17, 2020. And speaking to us today is Deacon Rich Johnson from Our Lady of Peace Parish. And following our services here today, and we have some family members that are going to share some sentiments and memories as well. But following those services, we will have American Legion Post 103 Honor Guard performing military honors before we then take him to his final resting place with his wife at St. Joseph's Cemetery. So on behalf of the family, we'd like to thank you all for joining us today. We'd like to thank you for the many years of wonderful friendship and support you have shown to the family, and certainly over these last few days, the tremendous outpouring of sentiments and memories and stories that have helped keep them going through these very difficult times, and sharing the many memories of the impact that Hector had on his friends, his students, his family, and his community. So at this time, I will turn things over to Deacon Johnson.
Good morning. Before I begin, I'd like to explain the service that I do. It's the service, my part of the service, is going to be approximately about 15 minutes, if they can say a few words. About three quarters of the way through my service, I will stop and I will say, now, if there's anybody that would like to say a few words, you can come forward. That would be your cue. I'm also going to do the service here, which is normally done at the cemetery, but I'm going to do it here because of the weather. It's cold outside. I want to express to the family that it's an honor and a privilege for me to be here and to be a part of this service. Hector and I go back a number of years. I've been ordained 26 years and my 4.5 years of studies, when I would have a bad week or bad month, Hector would always come up to me and he could tell, he knew, and he always gave me a pep talk. He was extremely supportive. I got to know him even better. He became the choir director at St. Joseph's Church, a part of Our Lady of Peace Parish. So for me, it's an honor to be here, for me to be able to express my final farewell to a good man. A good man had a beautiful heart. And with that said, let us begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. My dear friends in Christ, in the name of Jesus and of His Church, we gather to pray for Hector, that the Lord may bring him to everlasting peace, confident that God always remembers the good He has done in this life. Let us pray, asking God to gather him to himself. In the waters of baptism, Hector died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory, praising God forever. And let us pray. Heavenly Father, we as God's people share the pain of loss, but the promise of eternal life gives us hope. God of all consolation, we ask that you open our hearts to your word so that listening to it, we may comfort one another, finding light in times of darkness, and faith in times of doubt. Protect his soul by the power of the cross, and on the day of your coming, you will show mercy to all the faithful departed. And at your voice, the tombs will open, and the just who sleep in the peace will rise and sing the glory of God. We pray this in your holy name. Amen. A reading from Psalm 23, the Good Shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He guides me through the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Although I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are beside me. Your rod and your staff are there to comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of my foes. You anoint my head with oil. My cup is overflowing. Goodness and kindness will follow me all the days of my life. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for all eternity. The word of the Lord. Come, you who are blessed by my Father, says the Lord, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God. Have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way. Thomas said to him, Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The Gospel of the Lord. As family and friends of Hector, we have come together in prayer to remember and to honor the passing of the dear loved one. You know, in sacred scripture, Jesus gives us these comforting words. Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Eternal rest. What an awesome promise. But even with such a promise, losing a loved one is never easy. Even when we see death as a friend who brings an end to their pain and its suffering, Hector will be dearly missed. And we will have our moments of tears, and we will grieve and be sorrowful. And these are natural feelings. But let us also rejoice with him as he rejoices with the angels in heaven. The suffering is over. And today, because he believed in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and in the resurrection of the dead and life everlasting, he is now celebrating with God. And I know that because he demonstrated that belief in the way he lived his life. As a loving and devoted husband, father, brother, grandfather, great-grandfather, uncle, and a friend to so many people. A man who prided himself in serving his country and his community early on and throughout his adult life. After graduating high school, he served in the United States Army Air Corps, which later changed to the United States Air Force. And he trained, which I didn't know this, as many years as I knew him, he trained as a meteorologist. And also served as a trumpet player in the United States Air Force Band. When his tour of duty was up, he received a bachelor's degree in music education and a trumpet performance from the College of Music in Cincinnati, Ohio. And that's where he met Ruth, the love of his life, his wife of 55 years, your mother, your grandmother. Hector also earned a master's degree in music education from the College of Music in Chicago. And it was a school specializing in the training of music educators. And for more than 40 years, he taught music with love and dedication to elementary and high school students, beginning in Texas and ending in Ohio. And through his love and dedication, his enthusiasm, he inspired many of his students to go on and further their education in music, having a profound effect on his students and their lives. You know, the list of his accomplishments could go on and on. I was amazed at what he had done and what he had accomplished in his years, including teaching in Laredo, Texas, being a band and choral director at St. Mary's School in Sandusky, band director of Asheville High School. He was the choral director for Our Daily Peace, St. Joe's Church, and also serving as a choir director for the First Baptist Church here in Asheville. A member and a conductor of the Remember When Band of the Western Reserve. He was also active in the American Legion's Post 103 as a member of the Honor Guard and performed taps at many, many funerals. And these are just a few that I've listed. But in all that he accomplished in his life, his enormous love and dedication, music was overshadowed only by the love he had for you and his family. He touched your lives with kindness and love, with enthusiasm and dedication, with hope and faith. You were his world, and he made your world that much better. And I'm sure that he would be happiest being remembered as a man who truly loved his family. You all have special memories that made him who he was in each of your lives. Share them. They need to be remembered. They need to be passed on to your children and your children's children. And in doing so, Hector will never be forgotten. For he will always be but a heartbeat away and fond memories to be cherished. We need to remember Jesus' promise we heard this morning in John's Gospel, that Hector has a place in our Heavenly Father's house prepared by God's own hands. And knowing and believing this, we can find the strength to face this loss and all others like it. There's no more sickness, no more sadness, no more suffering, and no more death. So this morning, as we lift him up in prayer, expressing our final farewell, our Heavenly Father's arms were opened wide, ready to make all things new again, as God joyfully exclaimed, "Welcome, Hector. Welcome home." Let us pray. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother in sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you have bestowed upon him in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness. And with our fellowship of all the saints in Christ, merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith. That we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now this is the time when I ask her. Anyone has a few words to say, please come on.
Good morning, everyone. Tell you a lot, and there's so much about him in such little time. But first, I just want to say that my brother Dan, the eldest of my family, is unable to be here today, as he's been battling an illness since February, but he is watching and attending online, and our love and prayers to him, and we know he'd be here if you could. The year was 1970. I was becoming a sophomore in high school. We moved here just in time for band camp. I wasn't going to join the band, but I attended one day of band camp, and I realized I have to be a part of it because I had been there. I had moved from. I was still anguishing over leaving all my friends, but Dad was ready to go. He was ready to jump right in. He jumped right in like he'd been here the whole time. The second day of school, I rode with him because band was first period, so band was my homework. When we pulled up to the band room door, spray painted all over the door were racial expletives and phrases of "go back to where you came from." I was so angry and hurt, and he immediately calmed me down and he said, "Diana, they will learn that we are the same as they are, and we'll see that we have class, intellect, and talent. Now let's get inside Pittsburgh." He won them over in no time. The rest, as far as that goes, is history. He wasn't just talented, but he loved sharing and teaching his talents. If you didn't appreciate music, he made sure you learned about it. If you weren't an automatic talent, he made sure to find your special talent. I, for one, was never really as interested in playing an instrument like my older brother and my younger sister. However, I did play the clarinet, mediocre at best. I had the talent, but that wasn't my thing. He taught me my French horn, or taught me how to play French horn my freshman year at Sandusky St. Mary's, because he needed a good French horn. He made sure I learned it. And I didn't do too bad. But then again, look who my mentor was. When we moved to Ashtabula, the rumor was that the new band director's daughter was a phenomenal French horn player, and that the other French horn players better watch out because she was going to kick butt. Unbeknownst to them, my first love was twirling the baton, and my father would always refer to me as lady girl. He would rather I had an instrument in my mouth, but he accepted the baton twirling, and I found out from many of his teaching colleagues that he was very, very proud of my twirling. One of the best parts of my father is that he was a creator of tradition. When it came, it didn't matter what school he was at. He was at Sandusky St. Mary's from 1961 to 1970. Those were my growing up years and my more memorable. And he developed traditions there. And for those who don't know, one of the traditions was that he knew how to fire up games. If you were a football player, you appreciated him. We would come into the stadium of Sandusky St. Mary's and get the crowd all wrapped up. He had four fight songs that he taught everybody. Everybody at Sandusky St. Mary's knew every word to every fight song. And we would mark time until the team came out playing all four fight songs. And in, I'm telling you, you could hear the roar of the crowd all over the town. Then he took over the choral, the chorus of Sandusky St. Mary's. And they were known for what they called operettas back then. We call them musicals now. And one of the things that he did was when he took over the musicals, and I'm not sure what year it was, maybe 65, 66, they became so huge that they had to perform extra nights. And by the time, I'm going to say it was about 1968, we had utilized the public high school's auditorium because everybody in town came to the musical. He made them famous. He made Sandusky St. Mary's chorus and band well known throughout the area. I'm very proud of that. That's something I've always bragged about. Then we moved to Ashtabula and he began a tradition there. And one of the main traditions was one of his favorite songs, I Gotta Be Me. And anybody who was in the band would remember that the exit after every halftime show ended with I Gotta Be Me. But it had a crescendo to it that pounded at your heart, and you just felt a sense of so much pride that you belonged to that school. After I left school, it is my understanding from one of his students that he thought maybe everybody was going to get tired of that tradition, so he just made it a tradition for senior night. But it's still something that he did. He created traditions that are never forgotten. When we get all of these accolades and all these comments from people on social media of, I remember when he did this, and I remember when he did that, and I'll never forget that he was the composer of the alma mater at Sandusky St. Mary's. He just left his mark wherever he went. He loved his students. They may have called themselves his second children, but they were right in with our family. They were his first children, totally his first children. We went to clean out his office at home. Beautiful. He had decorated it up so sharply. Pictures of band students from the 60s all the way to he retired. You were all in there. He was a poet. He was a composer. But to me, my favorite composition will always be Sandusky St. Mary's alma mater. He used to get such a kick out of me singing it to him. Una vez más. One more time, Dad. Bear with me. Mom, cover your ears. Here I go. All hail Saint Mary's wife, our Alma Mater dear. Honor and love thy name, sing loud, be proud and cheer. Forever faithful, your sons will always be to you. Saint Mary's high, our loyalty. All hail to thee.
I'm so sorry. This
that was awesome. And one thing that my sister forgot to mention was that they still use that on RSA. And so, anyway, before I talk about that, I just would like to thank on behalf of my family the amazing Renata Timms of Adoration Hospice and Cole, who took loving care of Dad the last 7 years. There are sisters from another mister. We appreciate that. And of course, thanks to Country Club Retirement Center and the caregivers there, Gina Perry and all the others. It was so difficult for me to come up with things to say about my dad. How do you sum up someone like my father in just a few minutes? My sister just did an incredible job on that. I suppose if we all had hours and hours, I might be able to tell you every story about Dad that springs to my mind. But mostly everyone here or watching today, knew my dad, or as a grandfather, a great-grandfather, a teacher, a musician, a leader, a friend. But to me, he was just Daddy-O. You know, that was my nickname for him, and he liked that nickname. And even actually would sign his Christmas cards and birthday cards, Daddy-O. But so many of his former students have told me, my sister and brother, numerous stories of his support, of his selflessness and encouragement, that it's as if our jaws are permanently affixed to the floor. This is stuff we never knew, and stuff we never realized Dad ever did, and Mom too. But he did do wonderful things for his students that made him beloved among so many of you. And that makes me very proud to be his daughter. I also have stories about Dad, so many that I couldn't possibly tell them all. I could tell you about the times when he was really angry at me one day and then brought me home a puppy the later that evening. I could tell you about the times that Dad would take each of us out to dinner for our birthdays, just him and me, or him and Diana, or him and Dan, every year when we were kids, without fail. I could also tell you about the joys I felt going to Cedar Point and Sandusky to watch him and my brother and sister march with the St. Mary's High School band in the traditional opening day parade, and dreaming that one day I'd be able to do that. And I did, as a member of the Ashtabula High School. I could also tell you one time he crashed cymbals in my ear when he thought I was sleeping too late on a Saturday. I was a teenager, for Pete's sake, but in his words, he would say to me, "Don't sleep the day away. You've got things to do. So get your butt out of bed." But by the way, the only reason there were cymbals at our house was because Dad made me bring them home to clean and polish them. So I could tell you about the family road trips to see family in Portsmouth, Ohio, and Laredo, Texas, which took 3 days by car, and the times when motel front desks in the South would turn on the vacancy signs when they saw Dad, a man with brown skin, approach the door. It got to the point where he'd send in my mom instead so we could actually get a motel. I could tell you about the times when he'd worked side by side with Mom, not just as music educators, but also to fight for the interests of their fellow public school teachers and to fight for social justice in voting. My sister and brother would tease me about being spoiled because I was the youngest, which they felt meant I could get away with murder with my parents, especially with Dad, because I was Daddy's little girl. That's at least partially true, because I actually did get away with mouthing off to him at home. While it's not something I'm particularly proud of, I did it when I was a teenager, but it really was a sight to see, at least according to my mom, because one time I got it really good. It is so good that he was left uncharacteristically speechless, but really mad. And mom had to leave the room so dad wouldn't see her laugh. However, if I had ever knocked off to him in the AHS band room, I can guarantee you I would be standing here right now. So, but I could also tell you that he wouldn't speak to me for 2 weeks after I lost a challenge for my first chair percussion position that he had judged. Absolute proof that he never gave his children special treatment. I did challenge the new first chair immediately and then won it back a few weeks later, and he never challenged me. I could tell you about the time I was in 10th grade that he sat me down in the kitchen after dinner and tutored me in geometry because I was terrible at it, and because my teacher at the time walked a few flights downstairs to the band room to let dad know that I was in danger of doing it. Did you say embarrassing? Not just for me, but especially for my dad. No kid of mine is going to fail a class, he said. Because of his tutoring, I ended up with a C+. But regardless, I really was daddy's little girl. Sorry, not sorry, big brother and sister. You'll always be my little girl, he used to tell me. You'll be my little girl even when you're 40. Don't forget that. Well, I'm way past 40 now, and it makes me proud to say that I'm happy to always be his little girl. I'll be proud of that and of you, Dad, for the rest of my life. I hope I've made you proud of your dad. I love you so much. I wish you could ever. Say hi to Mom and our little sister, Lisa, okay?
I don't have any prepared remarks. It's just not me. I just want to say a few things about my grandfather. In 1980, January 1980, I had just turned 3 years old and I lost my paternal grandfather. So I never got to know him. My brother never got to know him. So I had one grandfather for the rest of my life. Here I am, 43 years old, and laying my grandfather to rest. So my brother and I, we've both been very lucky to have him all these years. Since I only have one grandfather, I took full advantage of that. And I got to know him very well and established a relationship with him that is just second to my own father. My grandfather was a kind man, but could be complicated at times. He was an intelligent man, but he also knew how to loosen his tie. And I love that about him. Most of you know professional Marty, and you've also been able to get back with him too. The grandpa that I know very well is the one that had shorts on, pulled all the way up, past his belly, and wearing his Bud Light t-shirt cut off. And those are the memories that I have that I think of my grandfather. But what he did for me in my life was, it's no secret that my love of politics, military history, American history, and this country in general, a lot of that starts with him. He taught me respect for the flag, respect for the military, which obviously I am a civilian, but I've always respected the United States Armed Forces. And I was always honored by his service. And I was always honored by how the larger than life presence that he had. Frank and I would be at band camp sometimes, and we're running around with kids. We were very bored. There was nothing for us to do. But all of a sudden, he kicked in. And he started his directive. He was up there on the dais. Old Frank and I kind of stopped, and we were impressed by that. And I said to myself, that's my grandfather. Look at the command he has over this entire room, or this entire field, or this entire Okay? Not a lot of people can say that. So I'm very grateful, and I also got a lot of pride in that fact. And it's no secret that Grandpa and I are good friends. We had a lot of conversations together. I did a lot for him. He did a lot for me. I learned a lot from him. He wasn't afraid to put me in my place. And to be honest with you, as I got older, and he was a little more ornery, and at times not as grandpa-ish, I wasn't afraid to put him in his place. And he actually would look, he would take it. He would listen and sit still for it. I know he didn't like it, but he let me do it. Because sometimes he did need to be put in his place. But other than that, he was a giver. He was funny in his own way. He was one of the most corny human beings that I've ever known. But it worked with him, didn't it, Frank? It worked with him. The nicknames, I could go on and on. The nicknames, the stories, and just... Even when he was getting ornery because he hadn't eaten yet, his diabetes was starting to take control. He'd still find a way to crack something real funny or even stupid, and he'd make us laugh. And my brother and I entertained Grandpa a lot, especially when we were kids, and he returned the favor to us, that's for sure. But like I said, I could go on and on. I just want to say to my grandfather, who had a lot to me. I love him. I'll never forget him. But I'm glad he's not suffering anymore because that just that wasn't Grandpa these last 2 years. That's not what he would have wanted. But he was tough. He did grin and bear it because those were the type of values he had. You know, he believed in toughing things out. That's my mom. And my aunt, so eloquently spoke before, but he just didn't want to see my dad. I'm glad he's with his mom. He will never be forgotten by any of us in this room, and all the lives that he touched, most of all of them, never be forgotten by me. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. And you did a beautiful job. Okay. And let us pray. To you, O Lord, we commend the soul of your servant. In the sight of this world, he is now dead. In your sight, may he live forever. Forgive whatever sins he committed to you, human weakness, and in your goodness, grant him everlasting peace. O God, glory of believers and life of the just, by the death and resurrection of your Son, we are redeemed. Have mercy on your servant, for he believed in the resurrection of the dead and life everlasting. Make him worthy to share the joys of paradise. The Lord Jesus Christ, by your own 3 days in the tomb, you hallowed the graves of all who believe in you, and so made the grave a sign of hope that promises resurrection, even as it claims our immortal bodies. Grant that he may sleep in peace until you awaken him in glory, for you are the resurrection and the life. And he will see you face to face, and in your light will see light, and know the splendor of God. So let us commend him to the Lord, that the Lord may embrace him in peace and raise him up on the last day. And Almighty God, through the death of your Son on the cross, you destroyed our death. Through his rest in the tomb, you hallowed the graves of all who believe in you. And through his rising again, you restored us forever to eternal life. God of the living and the dead, accept our prayers for those who have died in Christ and are buried with him with the hope of rising again. Since he was true to your name here on earth, let him praise you forever in the joy of heaven. Eternal rest granted to him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him and all our deceased loved ones again. When the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. May the angels lead him to paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome him and take him to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. Before I give the final blessing, I'd like to share with you these comforting words from a poem that was given to me a number of years ago when my mother passed away. And it really brings me comfort. It's called Remember Me. Remember me when flowers bloom early in the spring. Remember me on sunny days and the fun that summer brings. Remember me in the fall as you walk through the leaves of gold, and in the wintertime. Remember me in the stories that are told. But most of all, remember each day, right from the start, I will be forever near, for I live within your heart. The greatest gift we can give to those we love, living and deceased, is the gift of remembrance. So in prayer, continue to remember Hector and all your deceased loved ones. And now I invite you to bow your heads and for God's blessing. May the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of the Son, our Lord, and Jesus Christ. And may the love of God bless them and console you and gently wipe away every tear from your eyes. And may Almighty God bless each and every one of you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This concludes my part of the ceremony. I now invite the honor guard to come forward.
Before we have post 103 of the American Legion, do we have a post come forward and do their military honors, which will consist of a chaplain's prayer, gun salute, playing of taps, and then a flag presentation to his daughters. I would like to just call, I feel very honored and grateful to have been able to call Hector Martinez a friend of mine for many, many years. I wasn't in the band, but his wife was my choir teacher in junior high, and he was a presence at Ashtabula High School the years that I was there. And he will ever have a special place in my heart. And although it was a lot of things to a lot of people, one of his great being a father, and I'd like to share a poem called The Magic of a Father's Touch. It says, there's magic in a father's touch and sunshine in his smile. There's love in everything he does that makes our lives worthwhile. You can find both hope and courage just by looking in his eyes. His laughter is a source of joy. His words are warm and wise. There is a kindness and compassion to be found in his embrace. And we see the light of heaven shining from a father's face. This time I will turn things over to our honor. Thank you, Deacon Johnson, for your kind words today.
Hello. One. Two. Three. Four. One. Four. Our country's in mourning today. We're burying a veteran. The Honor of American Legion Post 103 are assembled here today to honor one who gave life and service for God and country. Because of his service, he helped our world to be blessed, our lives to be free, and our country to live. May the memory of today deepen our commitment for honor and departed comrades and friends. Mr. Hector Martinez.
Man who was born of woman is a few days and full of trouble. Now he cometh as a flower and cut down. He fleeth as a shadow and he continueth not. As God has taken the soul of our dearly departed comrade, we therefore commit his body to the ground to sleep, his soul unto God to keep. Let us pray. May the hand of God direct us. May the love of God protect us. And the way of God go with us all. God bless this family and their friends. Amen. This banner of love and devotion, which has been folded, is a living memorial of the courageous thoughts of our comrades. When you came here to honor this day, the blue field represents the skies that overlooks our land. He knows the waters of God eternal. The red stripes tell us of the blood, sweat, and tears that our comrade gave for the love of his country. The white stripes boldly proclaim the peace that he has tried to bring to our future generations. This is his flag. This is our spiritual heritage. Receive it with the tears of our eyes and the love from our hearts.
On behalf of the United States government, Department of Germany, the Great Commission, we do accept this flag. It's our appreciation for the love of the bless you. Thank you.
This poppy signifies that veterans should never be forgotten. This veteran will always remember the keeper of our freedom. He gave you the freedom to assemble here today without any fear. For all the freedoms you enjoy in the United States, you thank the veteran for the only ones that got them for you.
As a conclusion to our services here this morning, we're going to play a favorite song, I've Gotta Be Me, by Sammy Davis Jr. And at the conclusion of that, we will invite anyone who'd like to come forward and pay their last respects to do so. And then those of you that are going to serve as pallbearers, we can gather here in front, and then we'll process out to the hearse and make our way to St. Joseph Cemetery for burial. So again, thank you for coming, and thank those of you who are able to join us virtually. And thank you for keeping the Martinez family and the Perry family in your prayers as we depart here. Thank you.
Whether I find a place in this world, or never belong, I gotta be me. I gotta be me. What else can I do? What I am. I'm not changing my spot, and I won't give up this dream of life that keeps me alive. I gotta be me. I gotta be me. The dream that I see makes me what I am. That faraway prize, the world of success, it's waiting for me. I'll be tall. I won't settle down or settle for less. As long as there's a chance that I can have it all, I'm better alone. If that's how it must be, I can't be right for somebody else. If I'm not right for me, I gotta be free. I gotta be free. Daring to try, I'm daring to die. I gotta be me. I'll go if that's how it must be. I can't be right if I'm not right for me. I gotta be free. And I'm gonna be free. Daring to try to do it all.
Yeah. Thank you.